John Murray Press presents O Miriam, Stories from an Extraordinary Life, written and read by Miriam Margolyes. To H.A.S., the person least likely to listen to this audiobook. To be natural is such a very difficult pose to keep up. Oscar Wilde, 1854 to 1900. Cast your bread upon the waters and it will come back sandwiches. Ruth Walters, Mummy, 1905 to 1974. Oh, Miriam! Exclamation mark. I was in the lower third in Bardwell Road, Oxford High School, Junior School. Miss Willetts breezed in, ready for the fray. Right, she said briskly. Left, I immediately responded. That was the quickest sending out I ever experienced. I spent a great deal of time outside our headmistress Miss Stack's door, waiting to be summoned into her office. She would sigh as I strode in again, by then probably a little crestfallen. Oh, Miriam, what is it this time? Hello. Here we are again. I can't believe it. Well, you have to start somewhere. We all know the second book is the sinker, where all the goodwill and success won by book one disappears, and the dullness, the paucity of anecdotes, the weary recycling is eagerly seized upon, and the book and the writer pitted and then obliterated. Please remember that I'm 82, and my memory palace is more of an attic, piled high and haphazardly with all kinds of things. I'll try my best to deliver an interesting read, and, as before, it will be totally truthful. What maddens me is when people think I must have made it up. No, I didn't. I did take my clothes off for Augustus John. I was bullied by some of the public schoolboys who ended up in Monty Python, a.k.a. Light Entertainment's Bullingdon Club. I was the Cadbury's Caramel Bunny and a PG Tips chimp. But I was also Queen Victoria, Mrs. Mingott, and Sister George. I might have forgotten some details and transposed a date or two by accident, but what I wrote happened. For instance, in 1963, in the Edinburgh Festival, I wasn't in Ubourois, dressed in Gerald Scarfe's life-size vulva costume, looking like an enormous pink conch shell. I was in the sequel the year after. You know what they say. Once a cunt, always a cunt. Writing a memoir was not something I ever intended to do. I've never been able to remember my life. I've just lived it. I didn't know what else to do. I was always hopeless at learning my lines, but I love telling stories. COVID helped. Lockdown meant there was nothing much else to do. So, rather than headbutting it, I gently tickled my book into being. I talked to lots of friends and colleagues to jog the memory, and things fell into place. And when I got an offer I couldn't refuse from the publisher, I thought, let's go, girl! It's a disturbing thing to tell the truth about yourself. I knew it had to be the truth. I didn't know how people would react. I've offended a lot of people in my life, and some may think I'm very rude. But when I examine what I've achieved, I feel pleased. I don't feel smug, however, because I'm not complete yet. I've still got a long way to go. And like that first book, this one, I suspect, is not something that every grandmother is going to want to read. There is a chapter about what I learned from my grandmothers that I think mine would not have approved of. Heather still hasn't read This Much Is True, and I'm relieved. She gets really peeved, telling me that when she Googles her name, all that comes up is partner of Miriam Margolyes, as if the life and work of a distinguished historian of Southeast Asia is just a footnote to me. As 18 months ago, I'm sitting at the computer in Larcasella Montesi, the Tuscan farmhouse that Heather, Peter Lavery and I bought in 1973, and reflecting on my life. I thought this would be a peaceful period, but it isn't. For reasons which I will attempt to analyse, in the past decade I have become much more well-known, even referred to as a national treasure, or, more cruelly accurate, a national trinket. And the corollary of that is that I now receive appalling remarks in the comment pages of the Daily Telegraph, a nasty newspaper for nasty people I much enjoy reading. I do get The Guardian online, too. I have never been older or busier. Suddenly, I am overwhelmed with offers, documentaries, radio plays, theatre events, the Adams family to play grandma, voiceovers, the whole range of work available to performers, and many films, all over the world, in New Zealand, in Prague, in Australia. I even had to turn down Marvel, because the timing didn't work and the money wasn't enough. Almost everyone I know seems to be setting up a podcast, and the requests hurtle in. I refuse most of them. I like podcasts, although I think of them as radio broadcasts, which is what they would have been called back in the days when I worked in the BBC Drama Repertory Company. But there comes a point when not only do I weary of the sound of my own voice, but I fear others will too, and I'd rather quit when I'm ahead. I now spend much of my time on Zoom, a powerful, ubiquitous communications program which the pandemic made essential. Our computers stare at each other. We often forget to turn on the video or the sound or both. "Can you hear me?" we shout at each other, looking interestedly at the background, which can be a cheat, or really the journalist's messy kitchen or study. I love it when the dog or the husband makes a fleeting appearance and proves that it's real after all. Ruefully, I remark to myself, what took you so long? Why is it that now I am showered with the work which eluded me for so many years? I am not bitter. That would be a fool's reaction. I am grateful. It's late, but it's there. I have reluctantly come to the conclusion that it's my potty mouth, my bodily effusions, my appearances on the Graham Norton show, and the cameo messages which someone, not me, puts on TikTok that have propelled me into an area of public scrutiny and made me more famous than I have any right to be. Don't think I'm grumbling. I'm just gobsmacked. I've never had such loving, appreciative responses to anything I've done. Now, every day, people send me gifts, letters, emails, ask me to their parties, to read their books, and write something nice on the cover. Tell me that I'm making a difference to their lives, that I've given them new hope, made them laugh, made them cry, made them read Dickens. That's the best of all. Perhaps the pandemic forced people who don't read much to find a book and then to write to me. Complete strangers share their sex secrets with me. It's touching and humbling, and I'm extremely grateful, though seldom aroused. I've been travelling around the country, partly because of my last book and partly because of my television series, and I've been bowled over by the way that the public, when they see me, try to envelop and embrace me. Sadly, I've had to keep them at arm's length. I wish it were otherwise, but I'm so frightened of catching COVID. I brandish my walking stick like a weapon and often bellow, "Stop right there!" as they rushed towards me. Outside the Queen's Hall in Edinburgh, I was forced to poke someone with my rubber-tipped ferrule in his belly button to make him stay back. It has been extraordinary to me to realise that somehow something in me has evoked a mass loving trust in who I am. Assuming I was off air, I swore on my one and probably only excursion on the Today programme, talking about the iniquities of a particularly Teflon-coated Tory minister. My mortification was assuaged a little when friends later sent me news footage of a placard outside the House of Commons saying, "Miriam speaks for the nation." I had thought my career was over. I'm semi-crippled now. Usually that means you have to stop. And I don't think I can do theatre again unless I'm playing a character similarly disabled. I know Maggie and Eileen and Judy and Vanessa still tread the boards, and they're older than me, but they're fitter, bugger it, and good luck to them. However, I've told Lindy, my agent, to say I'm still available, and I am. The great thing with voice work is that you can do it sitting down. But before I went off to do a recent Doctor Who show on radio, I managed to throw in a fashion shoot. Yes, you heard that correctly, and it still makes me hoot with laughter. Vogue, the most glamorous and important fashion magazine of them all, featured me in their July 2023 issue and provided me with hair and makeup and a stylist. I didn't get to keep all the clothes, but just for a few hours, I was Barbara Golan and Kate Moss and Twiggy, all rolled into one. More on this to follow. Well, I wasn't them, but I was in their shoes, prancing around pretending I'm desirable. In case you don't know who Golan was, when I was growing up in the 40s and 50s, she was the leading model of the day, one of exceptional beauty and elegance. Her haughty demeanour, delicate bone structure and wasp waist came to represent the height of glamour. Somehow, I doubt that will be said in my Guardian obituary, but never mind. I made it into the fashion pages against formidable odds. I just wish Mummy and Cousin Buffy, owner of the smartest dress shop in Condit Street in the 1970s, could know and quell. You can never tell what's going to happen. You have to be open to the moment, in real life as in acting. Death is probably around the corner, drat it, just when I've got going. But as long as I carpe a diem, so to speak, and don't shirk a chance, life is there for all of us. I can't avoid mentioning now the horrors of this government. How hard for everyone it's made just getting by. How shabby the morals have become. How ungenerous and unloving and unwelcoming our attitudes. But let's hope I live to vote in the election to come. Let's hope you do too, and that you vote the way I'm telling you, which is basically avoid the Tories at all costs. So, is it just vanity that's making me write another book? It may well be. And then people might say, but what else have you got to say, Miriam? Well, my response to that is, just because I've written my autobiography, it doesn't mean that I'm dead. It doesn't mean I'm mute. I still have a life. I have thoughts. I want to find out who I am. I was pleased to discover how much I enjoyed putting pen to paper, or rather fingers to laptop keys. I didn't want to stop writing. But enough pontificating. What is this audiobook about? I know that it's about me and about my discoveries as I live. I've called it "Oh, Miriam!" exclamation mark because this exclamation has been such a constant refrain in my life, said in all kinds of tones, laughs and surprised gasps, sadly rather outweighing the orgasmic sighs, though there have been plenty of those too. I'm hoping for all those from you as you listen. My first book took a journey through my life. This one takes you through my heart and mind and the things I've learned and am still learning. I've written my own vagina monologue and my tale of the unexpected. As you'll hear, the following chapters range from how to stay married to swearing is good for you, so you know what you're in for. I don't want to hurt anyone, and I don't want to put anybody down. That's not the idea. But I will tell the truth, and sometimes the truth is painful. The public only sees you when you're up, so they think you're always up, but nobody is always up. Anybody who was would either be insufferable or very stupid. Of course I want to make you laugh. I want you to enjoy listening to this audiobook, but I hope the moments when I'm down might also be of use. I'm not climbing onto a soapbox here. I'm not trying to tell you how to live your life, just to tell you some stories from mine. I'm hoping that telling you about my thrills and spills will entertain you. I always have opinions, and people are always asking me for advice. When this morning set me up as an agony aunt, I don't think even they expected my bluntly telling one viewer that she should leave her husband. He sounded such a pig. And another one that she should go on a diet. It's so important to tell it like it is. But it is always just as important to be kind. After all, I've made it to 82, mostly in one piece. Admittedly, I did have a heart operation, and my dentist recently discovered that my gag reflex was not up to scratch. Probably all the cocks I sucked back in the day. But I'm still here. So off we go. Getting to know you. I've always loved talking to people. As a child, I used to talk about the housing shortage, obviously because I'd heard my parents talking about it. Of course, I would announce to visitors to the hovel, we can't move from here because of the housing shortage. And then I would hold forth to other children at playtime. You do know there's a housing shortage, don't you? Another of my favourite topics was tsuris. It's a Yiddish phrase that means ill fortune, bad luck, sadness. When I first went on holiday to Kingsgate near Broadstairs with my parents, I was playing with a little girl next door in Percy Avenue, and my mother heard me asking her, "Do you have tsuris?" "No," she replied. "Oh, we have plenty," I said, perfectly mirroring the adult cadence. Tsuris aside, there are not many similarities between me and Marcel Proust. He was a reclusive, droopingly moustachioed hypochondriac who spent many years in bed writing one very long book. I admit to not having read A la recherche du temps perdu. I keep starting it and then running out of puff. I am an actress, documentarian and citizen of the world, while he drifted off into a fey reverie of the past every time he nibbled on a moist, buttery madeleine. Admittedly, I do find a large piece of cheesecake leaves me rather sleepy, but, like me, he was fascinated by what made people tick. In 1886, a 14-year-old Proust discovered the confession album, which used a series of searching questions to build up a picture of the inside of someone's head. The questions were often used as dinner party entertainment or as a parlour game, an innocent precursor to truth or dare and spin the bottle. He realised that it was a way to jump over the banality of small talk and dive straight into deep conversation. And he was right. Here are 30 of the questions Proust became obsessed by in 1890. In fact, he asked 35, but these are the most interesting. The answers are mine. 1. What is your idea of perfect happiness? A reversal of Brexit. I'm writing these words in our terracotta-tiled living room at Larker's Cellar, having just stoked the wood stove, while our two enormous cats happily stalk around us. Heather's and my chief joy in life is to spend time here together. But along came Brexit, which has limited our time in the house we own. Freedom of movement, bollocks! We have to count the days or be fined and branded as criminals. I will never forgive those who voted for this insanity. The whole United Kingdom suffers in different ways, and my last years have been torn apart by the stupidity of it all. I want my life back. 2. What is your greatest fear? Having a stroke. I don't remember where I was or how I got the news when Mummy had her first stroke in 1968, but it changed my life forever. I thought I would never smile again. 3. What is the trait you most deplore in yourself? Laziness. I was born a sloth and never exerted myself again. Skiving off from games, curling up with a book or a woman whenever action was expected. I deserve my fate. Now immobility has become the norm. I enjoy work, but activity, moving the body, never. 4. What is the trait you most deplore in others? Meanness. I watch myself keenly for any sign. Mummy was generous. Even when after her stroke she could only use one hand, she would always grab an orange to give to her carer. Daddy was invariably mean. It may have stemmed from the poverty of his youth, but he would never take a taxi, always turn the lights off, sometimes if someone was still in the room. He guarded his cash, seldom gave tips, worried about money, never thought we had any, and feared complete economic collapse. I resolved never to be like him in that regard. I overtip with anxiety. However, I do have a rather unpleasant trait. I love treating friends to restaurant meals. They can have as much food as they want, but I won't pay for drinks. I rarely touch alcohol, and I resent the restaurant markup. It's up to you what you drink. I'm not paying for it. 5. Which living person do you most admire? David Attenborough. I didn't want to admire a politician. They seem uniformly disgraceful. Sir David is a mensch. He's worked hard. He's witty, forthright, honest, and cares about the planet, animals, and our responsibilities to each other. I've met him once, briefly, and felt absurdly tongue-tied. I hope we meet again before we both pop our clogs. 6. What is your greatest extravagance? Ice cream. Coffee is my favourite flavour. Although I don't drink coffee, it keeps me awake. Good ice cream never comes cheap, but it's worth it. I recommend Mullins Brasserie in Marketplace Margate for the best I have ever tasted, followed by Nardulli's on Clapham Common for the best in London, and Il Paradiso Café Trequanda for the best in Italy. I know it's bad for me, but I love it. 7. What is your current state of mind? Apprehensive. How can anyone not be, considering the state of the world? I've never known such a time when truth is ignored, when fame is idolized, the planet under threat. And of course my own fate awaits me. Mortality stares me in the face every time I look in the mirror. 8. What do you consider the most overrated virtue? Modesty. I think it's important to know your own worth. It's not conceited to claim excellence, as long as you're right. It's pointless to hide your light under a bushel, or indeed anything. Be proud of your achievements. Trumpet them if necessary. And if you have lovely breasts, please share them. 9. On what occasion do you lie? After a meal I haven't enjoyed. Lying is a mug's game. You'll always be found out eventually. But when I'm a guest, it behoves me to say something tasted delicious, even if it didn't. It's not an important lie. No one will die because of it. And to say something tastes awful is just rude and depressing. I prefer to keep everyone happy and say, yumbo. 10. What do you most dislike about your appearance? My belly. I inherited my belly from my mother. I remember noticing when she did the vacuuming in the nude that her belly hung down and flopped about, and I thought, oh, that's awful. I'll make sure I never get to look like that. Well, it's happened. I can't blame childbirth, as Mummy did. My belly was made all by myself, through years of overeating and under-exercising. Now it's my overhanging nightmare, and I have to put up with it. 11. Which living person do you most despise? Benjamin Netanyahu. There is no shortage of candidates for my despised list. The decline of decency, honesty, and justice in the world during my lifetime has been inexorable. And the nastiest of the current nasties is the Israeli Prime Minister, who should be in jail for breach of trust, accepting bribes, and fraud. The crime of his recent attempts to control judges in Israel is the most egregious. He is fanning the flames of conflict between Israelis and Palestinians and removing the chance of peace between them. 12. What is the quality you most like in a person? Kindness. Kindness is the quality I've come to value more than any other. Whatever the sex, recognition of others' humanity is crucial to civilization. Without kindness, we're worse than animals, and we do not deserve to inherit the earth. 13. Which words or phrases do you most overuse? As the actress said to the bishop. That phrase has made me laugh ever since I first heard it. Sometimes changed to, as the art mistress said to the gardener, which I believe was popularised by Beryl Reid in the 1950s BBC radio comedy series Educating Archie. They both convey a medley of sexual games and mutually pleasing activities, crossing all class boundaries, and never fail to raise a smile and a suspicion of naughtiness. Sex is often serious, but it's possible to have fun with it too. Apparently the French have their own version. Comme disait le hérisson en descendant d'une brosse à chaussures, as the hedgehog said when getting off a shoe brush. 14. What or who is the greatest love of your life? Heather. My partner of 54 years does not want to appear in any of my books. She is naturally reticent and finds my habit of self-publicity one of the more irritating of my character traits. Be that as it may, she is the love of my life, the most constant factor of my life, and the source of the most intense pleasure, physically, mentally, and emotionally. We are very different creatures. She is a scholar, I am an actress. But the breadth of her vision and the irony deep in her nature delight me. I am supremely satisfied. When I read that to her, she groaned and said, couldn't you just delete that paragraph? 15. When and where were you happiest? In 2012, touring with Dickens Women. 2012 was the bicentenary of Charles Dickens' birth. What better way to celebrate the occasion than a world tour of my one-woman show, Dickens Women? Started in 1997 at the Edinburgh Festival, it was the joint creation of Sonia Fraser and myself. Richard Jordan, who had worked on the original West End production in 1993, took me around Britain and to America, then handed me to Andrew McKinnon, who took me and John Martin, my pianist, around Australia and New Zealand. It was the culmination of my life's dream. What larks, Pip! When Andrew died suddenly a few months ago, a light went out in my life. 16. Which talent would you most like to have? Discipline. I'm not sure it's a talent, but I need it more than any other. I have talent. I need discipline to harness and organise it. I am lazy. I procrastinate. I allow myself to fritter away the most precious thing there is, time. What a pity. 17. If you could change one thing about yourself, what would it be? A stronger bladder. A weak bladder is a pissing nuisance. It's something I've never valued or thought about, but every time I go out now, I have to check where the loo is. I'm obliged to drink a lot of water because of my kidneys. Oh, the organ recital is so boring. I just wish I'd done pelvic floor exercises when I could. 18. What do you consider your greatest achievement? My friends. I am ferociously proud of the friendships I've nurtured throughout my life, from kindergarten to the present day. They form the rock on which my life is structured, and they continue to sustain and delight me. Friendship is a serious thing, and I take it seriously. 19. If you were to die and come back as a person or a thing, what would it be? Queen Victoria. For a long time, Queen Victoria has fascinated me. I've played her at least 3 times on TV, philanthropically in Blackadder, seriously in a documentary on the restoration of the Albert Memorial, and comically in The Windsors. 20. Where would you most like to live? Italy and Ireland. How odd that they're both Catholic countries. I do not find the Catholic faith at all attractive, but there's no doubt the people of both countries are intoxicatingly gorgeous. The scenery in which they live, the passion with which they eat and dance and laugh and drink are impossible to resist. 21. What is your most treasured possession? My cherub statue. He's a family heirloom, I suspect bought in an auction by my grandfather. It was in their garden for ages, then in Oxford. Then I brought it to my London home. Made of the finest Carrara white marble, the boy Cupid crouches on the wings of 2 doves and reaches for his arrow. He stands on a plinth 7 feet high, and he needs 6 men to carry him. I once thought I would sell him, but after I'd already struck a deal with an auction house, I found I couldn't bear to let him go. When I see him, it means I'm home. 22. What do you regard as the lowest depth of misery? To be without friends. It has not yet happened. I don't think I could cope. 23. What is your favourite occupation? Talking to an audience. There is nothing I enjoy more than to have someone to talk to. I look forward to book tours, to hospital waiting rooms, anywhere where I have people who are prepared to engage with me in conversation. It is a delight. It never fails. It could be called flirting on a grand scale. 24. What is your most marked characteristic? Friendliness. I have always expected to be liked. I am unafraid of new contacts. My round face is a friendly one, so people seem unafraid of me. I project guilelessness. Little do they know. 25. What do you most value in your friends? Loyalty. You might think show business is a murky world of betrayal and falsity. Not so. The overriding quality I have found in my friends in the profession is a steadfast loyalty. I demand it and I offer it in return. 26. Who is your hero of fiction? Jane Eyre. I am no bird, and no net ensnares me. I am a free human being with an independent will. 27. What is it that you most dislike? Tories! 28. What is your greatest regret? Being 82 and still fat. 29. How would you like to die? Quickly. 30. What is your motto? Carpe diem. Seize the day. Don't waste a second. Plunge into life and savour every moment. It's over in a trice. This is not the dress rehearsal. This is it. When did you have your first fuck?
My first week at Cambridge, I attended a crowded meet and greet at the ADC, where you forced your way through the frenzied throng very purposefully towards me, to my alarm. Me? Why me? When you reached me, you said without further introduction, "Do you think the Queen has periods?" It's still the oddest opening remark I've ever experienced. Classic Miriam, as I later realised. What did I reply? I've no idea. Speechless, probably. But it made its mark. I never forgot it. Carey Harrison.
Carey, son of Rex, was one of my first directors and is still a firm friend. Over 60 years later, my preferred method for breaking the ice hasn't changed much. I have always asked lots of questions. My technique is friendly but direct. I go for the jugular and ask the questions I think people don't want to answer. I've always thought that what people want to hide provides the key to their character. But conversely, there are things people love to talk about, and sex, a universal obsession, is one of them. Thus, a good question to start balls rolling is, when did you have your first fuck? I watch the face very closely as I ask. Sometimes people pretend to have forgotten, or perhaps they genuinely don't remember. Sometimes they smirk slightly, and I know the memory is there, and pleasurable. But if their eyes fill with tears, I quickly move on to another subject. Conversation has certain jobs to perform. To be able to talk entertainingly is essential, but so also is to listen. Some people think of conversation as a tug of war. I don't. First of all, everybody must be equal and be listened to. And the next thing is to show off. To dazzle and confound my audience is my hope. Conversation is both an art and a pleasure. Women and girls have the best conversations, roaming discursively around their inner lives and their longings. I learned so much from the talks I had with my mother, lying in bed next to her, staring at the ceiling, and knowing I could ask anything. It's like that with Heather now. Our conversations, after 54 years together, are as interesting and surprising as they ever were. We don't talk about sex, though. Our conversations range across politics, history, philosophy, music, books, death. Men, however, are different. I don't really know what men talk about. I don't know if they have longings. In 2022, I was thrilled to be chosen as the subject of Alan Yentob's BBC TV Imagine programme. But even when Mr. Yentob was supposed to be asking me the questions, I couldn't stop myself from grilling him. When we were in my kitchen, and he was cooking liver and onions for me on camera, I asked him, "When did you have your first fuck?" Though clearly embarrassed, he did answer that it was when he was 15. Then he said, "I don't think we'll put that in the programme." But they did. Jay Rayner reminded me of the first time we met. His mother, my great friend Claire, had invited me to a family dinner. I sat down at their kitchen table, looked under it, and said to his brother Adam, "Darling, what enormous feet you have! Do you have a huge cock?" I can't help myself. It's natural rudery. But it's not just that. I also truly believe it relaxes people, because they unite in being appalled. You can define it either as nosiness and impertinence, or as evincing a genuine interest in people. Of course, I realise it does upset some, and that disturbs me, because I really don't want to make them uncomfortable. But there is a thrill in getting a totally unrehearsed reaction. You learn more about the people you're talking to. And I was genuinely curious. Documentaries give me the opportunity to engage fully, talking, questioning, learning. It never occurred to me that you could get paid for being nosy. I now realise I've always been a documentarian. As soon as I've met people, I've always asked them everything I could. Age has only increased my curiosity and the urgency of satisfying it. I'm aware that my time is limited, especially now. I don't want to ignore gossip. Gossip, as long as it's not malicious, is fun and a great linker-upper of people. To have inside information and to share it does give a frisson of pleasure. But I think there are good questions and bad questions. Good questions get conversation flowing. They unplug the cork of good manners or natural reticence. Bad ones stop any promising discourse in its tracks. Money, sex, religion and politics are the things that we are encouraged to omit from polite conversation. People shy away from these topics, frightened to cause arguments or heighten disagreements. It's a very English characteristic to demur and sidestep when conversations become focused. But to me, it's meat and drink. I think they are exactly the headings we should make a beeline for. It's refreshing at dinner parties to handle the real things. In the end, I've found that people are always glad they did. I mean, these are the things that matter. I'd be happy talking about nothing else. For instance, I've always been happy to talk about money. I love money, and I want everyone to have what they deserve. I'm a trade union member. It's in the workers' interest to have accurate information. So I've always talked about my income with my colleagues and asked them what they earn, because it helps us all to establish what we should get. Are you Jewish? Is another question I'm often asking, though only if my Judah has been alerted by someone's looks, their voice, or, most often, their surname. Sometimes people bristle, but I'm just trying to connect. Exploring my conversational gambit has got me thinking about the evolution of language and when the idea of the interrogative came into being. Did the question come later as our human brains grew more complex? Think of cavemen grunting, kill, eat, fire. At what point do you think they said, why is there no food? Or, what do you want to eat? Or, where's the fire? Most communication is still made in the form of statements. Socrates, bless him, was possibly the first documentarian. He made dialogue important. And it is a wonderful thing, the awareness of another mind and sensibility stimulating one's own responses to the world about us. Questions demand answers. Asking a question is not just accepting someone else's statements, it's probing, curious, interested. It's one of the foundations of Jewish education. We call it pilpul. And I remember at Cambridge, Dr. Leavis explaining to us that a foundation of intellectual discourse was the yes, but response. Q and A is the most basic acknowledgement of the I and thou, the awareness that we live in the world with other people. Proust's questions are not bad as conversation starters, I suppose, but several are a little on the genteel side for my liking, and I'm not sure that the ensuing chat would be that fruitful or riveting. So I decided to draw up an alternative Miriam's questionnaire with 25 of my sort of questions. 1. When did you have your first fuck? 2. How long do you want to live? 3. Your biggest mistake? 4. Your greatest triumph? 5. What enrages you about modern life? 6. The greatest sin? 7. Is religion useful? 8. Should inequality of income be abolished? 9. Create an alternative 10 commandments. 10. Is space travel a waste of space? 11. Who should define madness? 12. Should cunnilingus be taught in schools? 13. Do you prefer to look forwards or backwards? 14. Best Jewish joke? 15. Would you change sex? 16. Why did you marry your partner? 17. Are you born in the wrong century? 18. Are you anti-Semitic? 19. Should obesity be a punishable offence? Daddy thought so. 20. Is the country always better than the city? 21. Has America's legacy bettered or worsened human happiness? 22. What's the greatest compliment you've been given? 23. Was it justified? 24. What laws have you broken? 25. Who benefits most from anal sex? I can't promise that you'll find my answers to all these in the chapters that follow. I've always hated being too predictable. But I hope these offer jump leads for conversations of the most galvanizing and enjoyable kind. How not to play grandmother's footsteps. Many of my friends who are grandmothers insist on looking after their various grandchildren. The joy this gives them is deepened by the knowledge that at the end of the day they can hand back the squalling infant and the house is theirs again. And that when the children grow up, my friends can rely on constant IT support. Alas, I have to pay someone to do that. I'll never be a grandmother, because I never had children, but I did have two fine examples of my own. What I learned from my grandmothers was where I wanted to follow them and where I didn't. My grandmothers were both products of their times, and yet different in every way. My mother had a poor opinion of my father's family, which was entirely reciprocated. She would probably admit she married, quite deliberately, above her station. And the Margolyes family agreed. After my parents' wedding in London in 1930, I don't think they ever met again. The Margolyeses never ceased to believe in and sometimes to voice their superiority. They felt a cut above. But they did have something in common. Mummy's father was a furniture salesman, and so was Grandma Margolyes' father. But Grandpa Margolyes had gone up in the world since then and owned a substantial jewellery business. Grandma Margolyes, we never said Granny, it was always Grandma, was born Rebecca Turiansky in 1874 in Odessa, then Russia, now Ukraine, and died in Glasgow in 1959. Grandma Walters, always so designated to distinguish one from the other, was born in 1864 in Gower's Walk, Whitechapel, in the East End of London, dying in 1953. What different journeys they had made in their lives, one geographical, one merely from rags to riches. But because they were such different people, with profoundly different attitudes to life and the world around them, the example they showed me is varied and occasionally puzzling. They were both, of course, Jewish, but born into two entirely different Jewish worlds. Although Grandma Margolyes left Belarus as a baby, carried across Eastern Europe in her mother's arms until they came to the port of Leith in about 1877 and got off the boat because they thought it was New York. Her birthplace came along with her and never left. You can take the girl out of Belarus, but you can't take Belarus out of the girl. She seemed always afraid. Afraid of dogs, afraid of people, afraid of poverty, afraid of being thought ignorant. She saw the world beyond as a threatening, unfriendly place, where people hated you because you were Jewish and would come in the night, set the dogs on you, and burn down your house if you didn't flee. Unlike Cossack Russia, Scotland wasn't a hostile place. There was little antisemitism there, not enough Jews, but she was fearful nonetheless. She married Grandpa Margolyes in 1897 in Edinburgh, where her father had his thriving furniture shop. They moved to Glasgow, had four children, whom she brought up lovingly but strictly, and she remained innocent and unworldly all her life. She wasn't a capable woman in the way that the women on my mother's side were. She wouldn't have dreamt of running a business or doing any of the things that Mummy and Grandma Walters had done. She believed women should open their legs, once married, of course, but not their mouths, should marry early and procreate, keep the dietary laws of the Jewish faith, go to synagogue regularly, and live in a Jewish bubble. Her husband, Philip Margolyes, had climbed from real poverty into middle-class merchant prosperity. By 1928, he'd become a well-known, highly respected businessman and a founding president of the Pollock Shield Synagogue. He was certainly richer than anyone else in the family. They'd always been peasants in a small Belarusian shtetl called Amdur, 36 miles from the Polish border. While Mummy recognised that Daddy's family were a cut above her, she also thought they were mean and despised them for it. She used to say they've got short arms and deep pockets. There is the cliché that the Scots are a little bit careful. So to be Scottish and Jewish, well, it's a double whammy. I choose not to follow that example. Grandma Margolyes looked a bit like the grandma in the Giles cartoon for the Daily Express, but she was much less combative. She was little in stature, as was Daddy, not fat but rather round, and always dressed in black like Queen Victoria. She often wore a little hat and had a somewhat rasping voice, with a throaty Yiddish "rrr" underlying her strong Southside Glasgow accent. I am often requested to demonstrate this, which I relish doing, partly because it brings her definitively back to me, and partly because everyone else who used to speak like that is dead. My grandmother never went to the shop. She stayed at home in Ayton Road, where her daughter Eva looked after her. Her vision of the world was therefore restricted, and I think she found my confident mother terrifying. She'd never met a woman who could sing and dance and strongly disapproved. Her primary expression was always one of deep disapprobation. You see, by upbringing, my grandmother was an Edinburgh Jew. She wasn't a Glasgow Jew, and she always had a hankering for Morningside. And as you know, Edinburgh people are famously snobbish, censorious. There's a famous joke about a woman going into Jenner's department store, once known as the Harrods of the North, on Princes Street. A lady goes up to her and asks, "Are you not Mrs. McDavish?" At which the woman rolls her eyes and says, "Oh, no, quite the reverse." With me, Grandma Margolyes was warm and loving, but she was always limited, inhibited, trammelled. She didn't know how to express emotion and would have found any outpouring of feeling rather suspect. In character, she was kind, but narrow-minded, forever expecting the worst. She was always pleased to see me and interested in what I was doing, but she had no concept of what kind of a person I was. She came from another century. She did love me. I know that. She was always affectionate, but clearly puzzled by my confidence and by my unruly hair. To be fair, almost every adult I met seemed to have a compulsion to get out a comb and Kirby grips to try to control the explosion on my head. It never worked. English manufacturers Kirby Beard and Company Limited of Birmingham made hairpins similar to the bobby pin, before the bobby pin's invention. She was confounded, too, by my loudness. She was always concerned with other people's opinion. Whenever I spoke, she'd look round to see if anybody had heard what I'd said and how they had reacted. She worried about what the neighbours would say, which is absolutely not what I've inherited. I don't give a flying fig what the neighbours think. I said fig there to please Grandma Margolyes' memory. In many ways, I have defined myself, albeit negatively, against her example. I loved my summers in Glasgow with her, but I always knew I didn't want to live her life, imprisoned in respectability and unable to speak my mind or choose my own path. Her lack of generosity left me determined to give without stint. Her example gave me the courage to be different. Grandma Walters, whom I got to know much better, because in 1952 she came to live with us in the new house, 409 Bambury Road, Oxford, was a completely different personality, and, if I am honest, a more welcome addition to my world. She was trim, elegant, with excellent posture. She had poise and always took a pride in her appearance. She chose her clothes with care. She wore cream silk blouses with pearl brooches at the neck and long black skirts. Her voice was sweet and clear, her manner confident and outgoing, her ability to show love apparently never-ending. Flora Walters, née Posner, was born in Whitechapel into a poor but respectable family. Like most Jewish immigrants, her parents were desperate to educate their children, and despite their lowly circumstances, Mummy's side wasn't mean. The Posners were exuberant, generous, lovers of music, dancing and theatre, in stark contrast to my father's family, who wouldn't recognise art if it got up and bit them. When Mummy told Daddy she wanted a permanent seat at the theatre, Daddy, utterly puzzled, said, "Whatever for?" Flora followed her elder sister Miriam, after whom I'm named, and became a teacher at the Jews' Free School in Bell Lane, known as the Eton of the East End, a school where many famous Jewish families, who were later to become enormously rich, had educated their children. She was a woman of power and influence, accustomed to an authority she naturally possessed. Like Mummy, Grandma Walters was an achiever, somebody who had run a house and a business and did things. She encouraged Mummy to have dancing, ballet and elocution lessons, and they went to the theatre and music hall often together. But becoming a professional actress was out of the question. Grandma had an agenda for her daughter, to catch a Jewish doctor, not to find a career. I was just 5 when her husband, my grandpa Sigismund, Siggy, Sidney Walters, died. But I remember him clearly. He had amazing charm. He was handsome and immensely seductive. I afterwards discovered he was a serial adulterer and had at least one illegitimate child. It was an enormous family secret that I only found out 2 years ago. But I think it was known in the family. I remember my cousin Buffy saying, "Oh yes, he was a real ladies' man. You know, Miriam, he used to have them in the stockroom at the back." My grandma must have seen the way her husband behaved with women, but despite everything, she adored him. I only knew her as an old lady in her late 80s, but she never spoke about it. The official line was that he was a wonderful man and everybody adored him, and I think that was true. I am sure his infidelity hurt her. Her expression was often sad in repose, and she could be quite sharp and bitter. But when she looked at me, her lined face had sweetness in it. I always knew I was her favourite grandchild. Admittedly, there wasn't a huge amount of competition, as Auntie Gusta's offspring, Jack, Doris and Buffy, her 3 other grandchildren, clearly found her a trial. She'd been living with their family in the big house in Hampstead, 94 Platts Lane, since Siggy's death in 1946. I vividly remember visiting with my parents as a young girl and seeing her struggling to walk downstairs, while my 3 cousins laughed and made disrespectful, pushing gestures behind her. I was young, but I was shocked. I knew that was cruel and wrong. When Gusta died, aged 50, following a heart operation, it was obvious Grandma Walters couldn't stay in Hampstead any more. Mummy had always intended that she would live with us in the new house on Bambury Road, and one of the 4 bedrooms had been designed for her with a fitted hand basin. But Grandma's arrival proved tough on my parents. The Margolyeses may have thought Mummy was common, but Grandma Walters deeply disapproved of my father. Mummy told me how as they were leaving.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.